To start the proceedings of the closing ceremony, I would like to invite on stage Mr. Bobby Sager, Mr. Mohammed Hanif, Ameena Saiyid, Mr. Asif Farrukhi. I would like to invite Ameena Saiyid, OBE, Managing Director, Oxford University Press, and Founder, Director, Karachi and Islamabad Literature Festivals, and Co-Founder, Children's Literature Festival, to give her closing remarks. Ameena.
Assalamualaikum, everybody. Bobby Sager, Dr. Asif Farrukhi, Mohammed Hanif, who should be here soon. बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया आप सब यहाँ तशरीफ लाए और मैं खान में दो ढाई दिन यहाँ गुजारे और उम्मीद है कि आपको अच्छा लगा और बहुत सेशंस में आपने बहुत आपको दिलचस्प लगे आई एम डिलाइटेड थैंक यू दैट वी हैव हैड अनदर सक्सेसफुल कराची लिटरेचर फेस्टिवल इट वॉज विद द फर्स्ट पोएम कंपोज्ड The first item of wisdom shared, the first thought expressed, or song sung, or dance performed, that the seeds of human civilization were born. In the struggle for civilization against barbarism, words, music, art, and scholarship, the very things that this festival stands for are the most potent weapons. These 3 days were powerful tools in spreading the light of learning, culture, and civilization. For us, this is not the end, but the beginning of another wonderful adventure, the preparation for our next Islamabad Literature Festival to be held on the 14th, 15th, and 16th of April in Islamabad at the Margala Hotel. And I would invite all of you, if you happen to be there, to please join us. And also this year we are having the Karachi Literature Festival in London on the 20th of May in partnership with Bloomsbury Pakistan and the South Bank Centre in London. This will offer a unique and inclusive experience at a mainstream venue. And we plan to celebrate 70 years of Pakistan's creation and history and culture through its literature and its arts. For me, the aims and also I for Dr. Asif Farrukhi, I think our aims in organizing these literature festivals were to showcase Pakistan's considerable contribution to literature and the arts, to create a public forum for dialogue and debate among authors, practitioners, artists, critics, and journalists from Pakistan and internationally. To project a fair and accurate depiction of Pakistani society by celebrating our diversity as well as posing our dilemmas. And we wanted to create an intellectual space in which the pluralism of Pakistan is acknowledged and intolerance is contested. We wanted to enable people from across generations, incomes, geographies to have free and inclusive access to our literary giants and our activities. And this is why we keep KLF free and open and inclusive. We wanted to build bridges of peace and understanding among Pakistan and also with its neighbors and the rest of the world. I would like to thank Dr. Asif Farrukhi, the co-founder of Karachi Literature Festival, whose keen awareness of good literature and unwavering ongoing interest in literature and the arts and in the festivals have been a huge asset. This year we've had the wonderful venue of the historical Beach Luxury Hotel. This hotel is part of the history of our beloved Karachi. Time was that at times it was the center of revelries and merriment of the elite. But for the past few years, Oxford University Press has brought books, readers, and heated debates to this venue. In a way, all of us are adding to the history of Karachi, and all of us are writing the story of Karachi ourselves. My thanks to the outstanding speakers and performers who set the underlying theme of the festival. Whether you have traveled all the way from Italy, France, Germany, Switzerland, Bangladesh, the UK, US, India, or Maldives, or from across Karachi and other parts of Pakistan, and I believe that some of you have come from Hunza and Gilgit to join us. I think all of you who are here you are the people who have inspired us and enlightened us to have this festival. So thank you very much for your gracious presence. Many literary prizes were awarded during the last few days, and I congratulate the participants and the winners. A special thanks to our sponsors who have helped make the Karachi Literature Festival a success, and without whom it would not have been possible. PepsiCo Pakistan, our title sponsors, UBL, the Consulate General of the Federal Republic of Germany, the US Consulate Karachi, the Manchester Literature Festival, the British Council, the Frederick Ebert Stiftung, Dai Awaz, Tapal Chai, Omor, Infarc Foundation, Getz Farmer, the Consulate General of Switzerland, the British High Commission, and the British Deputy High Commission, the American Institute of Pakistan Studies, the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, the Consulate of Italy, Karachi, the Embassy of France, Goethe Institute, Emirates, and Tehzeeb Foundation. I must thank the media whose representatives have been among us who are helping us communicate the spirit and the meaning of this festival to the rest of Pakistan and to the rest of the world, I would say. I would like to thank the wonderful Karachi Literature Festival team at Oxford University Press for their hard work in putting together this festival. Rahila Bakai, Zahra Naseem Haq, Muniza Ali, Anika Khokar, Sumer Qureshi, Zoha Amir, Faryal Farooq, Aman Aziz and his team, Salma Adil and her team, Irfan Ali, Asna Jamal, Faisal Usman, Batul Nasir, Sadia Mirza, and Nadia Ghani. Many thanks to the Awari family, the management and staff of the Beach Luxury Hotel, the Manhattan and Mediators teams, and our wonderful, wonderful volunteers. Thank you for our security personnel, our vendors who shared in making this a big success. And you, our wonderful audience, I really have no words to thank you for your presence and for your enthusiasm. And that is our greatest reward. Thank you and Assalamu Alaikum.
Thank you, Ameena. I would now like to invite Mr. Asif Farrukhi, founder Karachi and Islamabad Literature Festivals, to share his closing remarks. Mr. Farrukhi.
Honorable dignitaries and diplomats on the stage, Ms. Ameena Saiyid, Mr. Bobby Sehgal, and my beloved writer, Hanif. Writers, scholars, readers, Khawateen Hazrat, Assalamu Alaikum. It is always very hard to say goodbye, especially after we've had 2.5 days filled with books and book talks, writers and scholars moving across boundaries and across disciplines, creating innovative and interesting conversations, exploring, explaining what is going on within us as well as in the world around us, opening new possibilities and giving new cultural expressions. There are all kinds of discussions and exchanges that take place in the hallways as well as in the corridors, passages, and even the lawns. Underlying all this is the very fact that such a festival takes place and has now completed its 8th year. It is a celebration of hope as the eminent writer Ghazi Salahuddin has described it in a recently published article. I read it yesterday, so it's as fresh as that. A hope which has persisted and hope which has grown with the passage of time. Many of you will recall, as I do, the modest beginning. Ameena, you were there to start it with 3,000 to 5,000 people, and we thought, my God, this is big. Since then, people in Karachi have been voting with their feet. Did we cross the 100,000 last year? Did we go beyond that figure? Almost, but we are still counting. As this festival is being replicated in many cities of Pakistan, lighting up beacons of hope in the country starved of books and independent ideas, I'm happy to see the number grow, just as I want to see the programs become even more rich in content, diversity, and continued relevance to society. Each success leads to a renewal of the challenge, but then the challenge makes everything worthwhile. Even going beyond this to Islamabad and London, and after London, what next? Maybe the world. Kulkarni ji, who's sitting right in the front seat, has been talking to me and trying to convince us of having a Karachi-Mumbai Literature Festival. Why not? Why can't we dream of a caravan of writers and scholars holding hands and exchanging books instead of insults? As the list of this time's festival turns into memories, and as we are all ready to turn on a new page, I would have liked to comment on some unusual and unexpectedly delightful sessions, from the brilliant discussion with Hanif and Mirza Wahid to the engaging conversation with the German writer Ilya Trajanov, who has named the book Collector of Worlds, and this is probably what we all are. तकरीबात के इस सिलसिले में एक इजलास ऐसा भी हुआ जो मुझे एक तरह का संगे मील मालूम होता है. इसी स्टेज पर अभी लगता है कि चंद लम्हे पहले मुश्ताक अहमद यूसफी तशरीफ़ लाए और जहरा निगाह के साथ हम कलाम हुए. वो पहली बार यहाँ तशरीफ़ लाए और गुफ्तगू में शरीक हुए आप सबको महसूस किया और हमारे लिए इफ्तिखार का बायस बने कि गोया उन्होंने अपनी तरफ से हमारी छोटी सी काविश को कबूलियत की सनद बख्श दी. उनके लातादाद मद्दाह उनकी ज़बान से निकले हुए चंद अल्फाज के मुंतज़िर रहते हैं और उनकी शिरकत की वजह से हमारे सर फ़ख्र से बुलंद हो गए. सितारों के इस झुरमुट में कई नाम याद आ रहे हैं. हमीदा खोड़ो, जो पिछले सालों तक यहाँ थी, आज हमारे दरमियान नहीं हैं. इसी लॉन पर अब्दुल्ला हुसैन मेरे सामने बैठे दिल खोल कर कहकाह लगा रहे हैं. मुझे आज फेसबुक ने बताया कि आपकी यादों में ये तस्वीर मौजूद है. सुबह सवेरे समंदर के रुख उड़ने वाले परिंदे मुझे इंतज़ार हुसैन की याद दिलाते हैं और ऐसा लगता है कि वो किसी रविश पर टहलते हुए छड़ी ले टेकते हुए आएंगे. और अपने मखसूस अंदाज में जब उन्हें कोई सेशन अच्छा लगता था तो वो कहते थे, वाह जी वाह. मुझे ऐसा लगता है वो आज यहीं कहीं मौजूद हैं. उन लोगों की बदौलत कैसी यादगार महफिलें बरपा हो गईं. इनके साथ ही मैं नहायत फ़ख्र और आजीज़ी के साथ नाम लेना चाहूँगा किश्वर नाहिद और मसूद अशर, मुस्तनसर हुसैन तारण और नूरुल हुदा शाह, अनवर शऊर और इमदाद हुसैनी. मैं सलाम अकीदत पेश करना चाहता हूँ फहमीदा रियाज को, जो सुबह आई थी और एक झलक दिखा के चली गईं. वो आजकल बज़ाहिर बीमारी से निढाल हैं, मगर जुरत और इस्तकामत का एक ऐसा पैकर हैं और अपनी तख्लीकी सलाहियत से मालामाल हैं. उन जैसे लोगों की मौजूदगी से दिल बढ़ जाता है, तारीकी जैसे छटनी लगती है, उम्मीद की किरण जगमगाने लगती है. उम्मीद की शमा को जलाए रखने में हमारा साथ दिया आप सबका शुक्रिया. फिर मिलेंगे अगर खुदा लाया.
As you know, Dr. Hamida Khoro passed away early this morning. May I please request you to observe a minute's silence.
I would now like to invite Mr. Bobby Sager, an American businessman, philanthropist, photographer, and inspirational speaker to deliver the keynote speech. Mr. Sager is the founder of Sager Family Traveling Foundation and Roadshow and the author of two books, The Power of the Invisible Sun and Beyond the Robe. Mr. Sager.
Thank you. I don't know how inspirational I am as a speaker. You'll have to judge that when I'm done. The first thing I want to say is thank you for being here, for taking your valuable time to listen to what I have to say. I spend 10 months a year traveling for the last 20 years to many, many countries in the world. And I've had the great fortune to spend a lot of time in Pakistan. I come from the United States, and there is a narrative in the media and with certain parts of the population that the people in Pakistan are somehow difficult or problematic. And I'd just like to say to you, as someone that has met people all over the world, that in my opinion, the people in Pakistan are some of the warmest, most considerate, and most compassionate people I've met anywhere in the world. And I feel like it's my responsibility, having had that experience with so many of you, to correct people's perceptions in the United States and beyond. So I've decided that I'm not going to start the way I was going to. My great friend Solomon was just talking to me before I came up about something that happened to me. It was just 3 years ago last night, and this is a conversation about the importance and the power of gratitude. So 3 years ago last night, I sat in my newly built home near Boston. I was there with my son Shane and my daughter Tess, and we looked around this house. It was late. It was 10, 11 o'clock in the evening. And I looked around and I said, this house was a very difficult house to build. It's on a little island, so it was just a very, it was difficult. Looked around and said, wow, after 6 years of building this house, there's nothing left to change. The house is finally done. Just 6 hours later, it burned to the ground with me trapped on the second floor. I came within a minute or so of dying in that fire. And it made me think a lot about how we take tomorrow for granted. When I put my head down on the pillow that night, I couldn't possibly have imagined that in a few short hours I would be fighting for my life. So, taking tomorrow for granted robs us of the power of today. Too often we wake up, myself included, on Monday and wish it was Friday. And when we do that, we're wishing away something like 70% of our lives. So I'm writing a new book called More. It's a book about thankfulness. And in it, I talk about a concept that I call Tuesday afternoon. Tuesday afternoon is meant to represent the everyday, the so-called ordinary, and the further observation that our extraordinary lives are made up almost entirely of ordinary days. Birthdays, New Year's Eve, those so-called big days, those are just the icing. The cake is all the ordinary days in between. So how do we make those days, thank you, how do we make those days more rich and more vivid? How do we wake up and say, thank God it's Monday? So 16 years ago, I decided that making more money wasn't going to make my life any better. I didn't want to buy more houses and things and so forth. And so I decided to stop working and to try to reapply the same skills that I used to make money to make a difference. My children at the time were 9 years old and 6 years old. My wife and I took them out of school and we said, you know what, we're going to go into the world. We're going to see if we can find ways to help people, but we're not going to send a check. We're going to go there. We're going to live in the villages, in the refugee camps, wherever it is that we're trying to help, long enough so that we can really understand what's needed, not go into a place and just tell them what's good for them, and live close enough to the ground so that we can really listen. Because my experience over these many years of going around the world and seeing other people trying to be useful is that much too often people come into a situation, tell them what they're going to do for them, and then leave. The way that we do it is that we never give a handout. We only help people to help themselves. And there's a dignity to that that's really critical, because pure charity can cripple people. It doesn't make them feel good about themselves. It isn't really sustainable. So when we are in these places and we can look the people that we're trying to help in the eye and feel their humanity and let them feel ours and let them know that they're important enough for us to be there, that's the kind of impact, that's the kind of sustained impact, that's the kind of dignified impact that we seek to make. So I didn't decide to start this foundation and to go into these difficult places to make a difference because I felt guilty that I had made too much money. I wasn't touched by an angel. It was a desire on my part to live the fullest possible life, to learn things and feel things and experience things. That's the fullness in life. And I only ever made money so that I could have choices in life. And then it's a matter of what you do with those choices. And my choice was to take Tess and Shane into the world to see the way other people live outside of our bubble, and to be grateful and compassionate human beings, because I was described as a businessman and a philanthropist and a photographer and so forth. My most important job is that of a father, and so my motivation in doing this had everything to do with the fact that I had these small kids and that I wanted them to grow up as compassionate, open-minded, open-hearted human beings. So can we put the first slide on, please? Maybe the second slide. The slide that's not up there would say, but next slide, this is my son who's saying, I don't really care who he is. It doesn't really matter to me very much. So that's the other side of this. Go to the next slide, please. This is a camp here in Pakistan that we lived in after the earthquake in 2005. When something like 3 million people lost their homes, and I think it was something like 80,000 people died, we were distributing aid, mostly blankets and heaters. And what I think about when I look at this picture and my kids' lives on the road is a quote that Mark Twain famously said, which is, never let schoolwork get in the way of your education. Next one. This is that same camp, and remember I was talking about dignity before. The people have made little front yards in front of their tents to have that little, that sense of home, that sense that here's where I am and this is my spot, and I'm going to have, I'm in a situation, but I still have dignity and I still have strength. Next one. And in that same camp, this little boy, so proud of his little toy. For me, people that have a lot, it's really hard to make them happy. People that have almost nothing, almost anything makes them happy. These three kids, so I'm a photographer. I have done books and exhibits and so forth, and I was saying in a talk that we had right before this, my photography is, I use it as a way to connect with people. There's just the photograph is almost a detail at the end of the interaction. These three kids are in Kabul, Afghanistan, and in this bombed, you can see the kind of distance and sadness and maybe even suspicion in their eyes. And just a second later, same kids, and the only difference between that top picture and the bottom picture is me going like this. Because in that bottom picture is filled with opportunity for friendship and connection. And all I did was make myself vulnerable. All I did was make that kind of human connection. Too often we're looking at someone as the other, as an object, instead of as a fellow human being. The next one. So here's another example, and I go, and this is what happens. Next one, please. This little girl in Afghanistan. So everybody help me this time. Ready? One, two, three. Next one. This is a man in Rwanda who I think he has a look in his eye like, you know, maybe he wants to beat me up. And just a second later, help me out. Human connection. It's so easy to do. And by the way, this second picture, this isn't the end of the story. That's the beginning of the story. This isn't just a matter of making a funny sound and, you know, and taking a picture. This is making that kind of connection so that we can have a conversation, so that I can listen to what he has to say, so that he can feel who I am and I can feel who he is. Next one. And ready? And next one. This is a Tibetan monk. I thought most Tibetan monks were supposed to look kind of happy. He doesn't look very happy. Ready? And I think the last one now. I love the way his eyes are going to light up. Ready? Help me out, everybody. One, two, three. And I think the last one, maybe. Yes, this is the last one. Okay, last time. You aren't participating. Please. One, two, three. There, you made him smile. And now you have the opportunity to make him your friend. Next one. This is a little boy named Moises. He's in Rwanda. He's a child soldier. A child soldier. He killed 5 people before he was 9 years old, fighting in the Congo. Next slide. This is his soccer ball, his football, made from whatever was lying around. this little boy Moses was the inspiration for this football. This football is indestructible. You can stab it with a knife, you can drive a truck over it. We've had elephants stepping on it and they couldn't break it. Remember I said before that we don't do handouts because it robs people of their dignity. So the only way that you can get one of these footballs is by entering into a program that uses football to teach life skills, to teach leadership or to teach about HIV or drugs or so many things that are important life lessons. And when I was distributing these balls to these child soldiers, friends of Moises, I said, because this ball is indestructible, it will be in your life for a very long time. So think about the fact, now these are kids that are 10 years old, maybe 15 years old. Think about the fact that because this is indestructible, one day you can play football with your sons and daughters with this same ball. That you can start to imagine the possibilities, the light at the end of the tunnel, the power of hope. Next one. This little girl, her whole village was destroyed in that earthquake. What I say about her, and this was taken maybe, I don't know, a week or two after the earthquake, that you can fake a smile with your mouth, but you can never fake a smile with your eyes. Next one. And this little girl's face is burned. I'd ask you to think about this as we go through our busy lives. Think about what you got upset about today. The traffic, you had to wait in line to get food or somebody, whatever it is. Think about what you got upset about today and think about how it compares with her daily challenges. It's hard to be thankful without some kind of context to appreciate what you have. And I think that she provides really, really big context. By the way, taking Tess and Shane into the world and living in refugee camps and living in slums and villages and all these difficult places, helping them to be more grateful human beings is not about seeing what other people don't have and then thinking, oh, okay, I guess I should be happy with what I have because I have more than what they have. That's not what it's about at all. What it's about is the idea that when you are with these people that have so little and that live such difficult lives, that you still see the dignity and the strength and the functioning of a family and hope, even with all of that. And that's how you become a more thankful, grateful human being. It isn't, I have more than they have. That's not it at all. Next. So this is a man who, very unfortunate man, who I photographed in Cairo. And I put this slide up right now so that I can talk just for a minute or two about the idea that, you know, people think about the world and that it's really, there's so many problems and it's so difficult, and you say, you know, what can I do? As one person, what can I do to make a difference? You know, how can I can't really kind of move the needle. I'd ask you to think about the idea, something that I write about in one of my books, of concrete baby steps. Concrete baby step is just the way it sounds. It's something that you do for someone else, could be one-on-one, whatever it is, that makes a small difference. Because if I do my concrete baby steps and you do yours and you do yours and you do yours, it's when we add all those up cumulatively, that's how we make a difference in the world. But the math only works if we're all doing it. So this is not a spectator sport. This is not something that we can just leave to, you know, governments and big NGOs and so forth. Everybody, I would implore, and I'm sure that, you know, that many of you, you know, make a difference in your own way and with your own passions and your own circumstance. But this is something that we need to make a part of our everyday lives. Making a difference in the lives of others should be part of our everyday lives. So this next thing I'm going to show you is a short video. These are photographs that I've taken in like I said before, remote villages and slums and refugee camps, and they're photographs of child soldiers and displaced people and just kids who are living, you know, extraordinarily difficult lives. The book is called The Power of the Invisible Sun. Invisible Sun is a metaphor for hope. The music is by my friend Sting. And yeah, let's just roll it. Don't feel bad for these kids. They don't want our pity. I didn't show you their photos so that you'd say, oh, look at those poor kids, I want to give them a hug. Hopefully, you take strength from their strength. You feel more thankful in your own lives. And in return for that strength and that thankfulness, you go find ways to give other people hope. Not just by giving money, but by giving something of yourselves. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sagar. I would now like to invite Mohammed Hanif, a journalist and the author of The Case of Exploding Mangoes and Our Lady of Alice Bhatti, to deliver his keynote speech. Mr. Hanif won the Commonwealth Writers Prize in the Best First Book category in 2009 and is also the recipient of the Shakti Bhatt First Book Award. Mr. Mohammed Hanif.
Ameena, Asif, thank you very much. Thank you all for being here. This is a little piece that I wrote after I read something my friend and novelist Mirza Wahid, who is here at the festival this year, recently in an interview talking about Kashmir, he wrote that that in Kashmir poetry grows out of graveyards and gardens. And that somehow stuck me, and I was thinking about that. So I'm going to read this little piece to you. Recently, I visited the grave of a friend who died here in Karachi, but was buried in Multan. While escorting him to Jinnah Airport for his last departure, I remembered an old argument about living and dying in Karachi. A friend had once told me that you are not really going to become a native, a Karachiite, you are not going to belong if you don't stop going to your village for every Eid, and more importantly, if you don't stop burying your dead in your ancestral village. Karachi's graveyards may be overpopulated, but so is the city, and that's why you are here. Sitting in that ambulance racing towards the airport, I thought, it didn't matter now. Nothing mattered anymore. And Multan, anyways, has more atmospheric graveyards. Recently, I was in Multan and I thought I would pay dear departed a visit. It was a modest grave with mud plastered over it, and the gravestone carried a couplet by my friend. I paraphrase, life was like a dark sky, but my pen illuminated that darkness of the night. I cursed him under my breath for leaving me in this world where you are supposed to fight against this dark sky and all you have is a pen. I thought we were done with all that pen and sword stuff. We can fight all our battles on Twitter now. But now even a rant in the cyberspace can bring that dark sky crashing over your existence and you can just disappear. Most days I myself use a cheap ball pen, and I struggle mostly against not a dark sky, but an A4 blank sheet. Printed words delight me, but I have no shame in admitting that most writers and journalists love nothing more than their own byline in print. They don't really think about the oppressive dark sky of our existence. I probably shouldn't say it in front of young people, as they are always looking for optimistic mentors. But sometimes I feel that the words we write can't change anything. They can distract you from what you really, really want to change in your life. Yes, I do know that some words can illuminate the dark sky for a moment in which you can see our world in bright relief. We can see it in its entirety, but then it grows dark again. Like when you see an illuminated Karachi when you're coming in to land at night, and we spend the time till the next illumination by trying to remember that bright outline of a world that we glimpsed at that moment. Why is the sky so dark? Why does our pen need to illuminate it? Sometimes, as a writer, you are transported from solitude of your desk to a room full of people. lovely people who have read your book, or at least intend to, or people who have an afternoon free and they think that talking to a writer or a published author, as they like to call them in India, is a better idea than looking at your people's holiday pictures on the internet. And then one of those lovely people raises a hand and asks in a very concerned, somber tone, "Don't they say anything to you?" We both know what they mean by "they." We know that what they mean by "say anything." What they basically ask you is, do you receive threatening phone calls? Do you worry about someone following you when you go for your school run? Have they ever picked you up? And if they haven't done it to you, surely whatever you're writing is not worth it. If the sun is shining and the sky is blue, your pen can't really illuminate much. When we ask each other these things, we are not scared of each other. We talk in riddles because we are just being polite to each other. My answer is always well rehearsed. No, they haven't made any threatening calls. No, I'm not important enough. They don't read books. I simply reassure myself for those concerned about me that I haven't done anything. It's important to keep your answers short, but I usually want to tell them that what we perceive as our enemy, the guardians of this dark sky above us, are also citizens like us. They might have the ability to tap our phones or hack into our emails, but surely they also watch kitten videos on YouTube. They may have to break our bones one day or take an electric wire to our private parts, but I assure you they have the same worries about where to find a good maths tutor for their children. They are as patriotic as we are. Just like us, they also believe they know better what's good for the society. If they are trying to scare us through abductions, could it be that they are also scared of us? This question brings us together. This question is about how scared should we be. That question brings reader and writer together, writer and other writers together, and writer and that person on the second-hand bookshop who knows if he can recommend that book to a new, enthusiastic reader. And then you usually have a wise friend who tells you that it doesn't really matter what you're saying. If you know how to say it, you are going to be fine. I convince my wise friends that I'm respectful. In my disagreements, in my jokes, in my criticism, I am respectful. Even when I'm showing my contempt, I don't forget to add a dash of respect. A punchline might be a matter of life and death when you're trying to finish a paragraph, but you don't want your life to be a punchline to a long-running joke which starts with, "You should have known better." Grammar and punctuation and vocabulary and rhymes and meters are not enough. We must learn some manners. We must learn to respect institutions, faiths, traditions, and sometimes we must learn to expect the goons on our streets as well. So as readers, we should know better. There are certain things that we should not say about writers, journalists, poets, songmakers. These are the things that we should not ask them. Let's not call them brave. Let's not call them brave even if we really, really believe that they are brave. Soldiers are brave, and boxers in the ring, a woman ready to give birth without epidural, and Karachi's minibus drivers are brave because they'll get you to your destination dead or alive. Their job demands bravery. If they are brave, they'll do their job better. If a writer is brave, there's no guarantee that he's actually good at his job. Even if he's competent or if he'll ever finish that book that he keeps saying that he's writing for years and years. When you call someone brave, you're basically saying, "Are you slightly soft in the head? Do you not know what could happen to you? Do you not read the paper? Or forget that. Don't you ever go on Facebook? Or do you want that thing to happen to you that could claim that so that you could claim innocence and you could become a victim? You could hope that a few more will read your book and some more people will recite your poems. Surely there should be easier ways to find more readers." And if they go missing for a couple of weeks or suddenly disappear from your social media feeds, stop shouting from the rooftops. Just assume they have fallen on bad times. Don't ask them what happened during the time they disappeared. And then you can ask that question, what really happened? Some people have tried, but there are no answers. No, the state is not always that bad. There is not always torture, but there are different kinds of technique where there is something really not happening to you. Sometimes you could hear your mother screaming in the next cell, but your mother is not there. In real life, your mother is at home and is suffering the ultimate torture, that why aren't you home yet? We must not ask them to take responsibility for all the evil in the world. When I became a writer of novels, I used to say, I have responsibility as a journalist, but I have no responsibility as a writer. My only responsibility is that I shall not bore you. But now I believe that I must occasionally bore you. I must tell you things that you'd rather not hear. Don't ask them what their book is about. They'll find out when they read a review. You might have written something funny, a love story maybe, and you might find out that it's read as a terrifying insight into a country at the end of the world. And never ask them how much money they make. It'll always be less than what an average lawyer makes. Sometimes writers are not illuminating the dark night, they're just doing their job. When Muhammad Khalid Akhtar, in his very funny novel, Chaki Wada Mein Visal, invites his friend for a cup of tea, his friend's friends include a bear, a monkey, and a goat. They also have to come inside the cafe, sit at the table, and drink their tea. Because it's good manners. You can't park your companions outside a cafe while you go in and have tea. Abdullah Hussain Saab used to be a regular here, and I miss him a lot. When a character in his novel Nadar Log goes into a ripe wheat field to meet his lover at night, he sets the field on fire. He gets a thrashing from his elders, who ask him that what really happened in the field, and he says that he lit a match because he wanted to see his lover's face. This probably is the job of a writer, to burn down the field for a few moments of illuminations. Where is the dark sky? Where is my pen? And it's very convenient to tell me that I'm my own dark sky and it's my pen trying to illuminate it. I can't ask my late friend these things because he's 6 feet under in a graveyard named after a woman. It's called Mai Pak Graveyard, which means a pure woman. I have never heard of a graveyard called Pak Mard, a pure man. Because maybe we all know that pure men don't exist. Or we don't need to be pure, because after all, we are our own dark sky and we wield the pen that illuminates it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mohammed Hanif. Next up, I would like to thank all the speakers for their presence and for their kind words. We are getting ready for a performance by Seamus Sayed next up.